Hi guys, and welcome back in X-Plane 11. Oh yeah, we are back in the old sim. It absolutely isn't dead yet, even though MSFS of course is released and fully going by now. But we are going to do another full flight tutorial in the older sim today, namely for the Hot Start TBM-900, one of the most advanced and feature-rich general aviation aircraft available for any sim right now. And we are going to fly in Germany today from Weeze Niederrhein, Echo Delta Lima Victor, to Paderborn, Lippstadt Airport, Echo Delta Lima Papa. We are going to use PF3 ATC today, and we have planned to cruise at flight level 150. We are going to see what happens if everything is working out as expected. And also, good old X-Plane 11 can still look totally amazing, as you can see. We have Ortho 4 XP coverage, we have Vivid Sky and Active Sky XP providing the weather as usual in my X-Plane 11 gaming, so to speak. And now we are slowly getting ready to power the aircraft up. But before we get inside the cockpit, let me show you some of the menus that we have at the left-hand side right here. We have the Airframe Manager, which you can use to select a livery and create your registration for it, because that gets dynamically drawn onto the fuselage. And then this airframe will be used continuously through all your flights, because this aircraft features wear and tear, for example. So components will wear down and you have to replace them maybe at some point. So that's the Airframe Manager. Also, we have the maintenance hangar that you can use to inspect and also replace broken parts, for example. So you can inspect the engine, landing gear, electrics, avionics, lights, airframe and miscellaneous. And you can then further inspect the part that you select in the upper row and have a look at all the components. And also at real life cost, so the repair cost and the replacement cost, that is quite expensive in real life. Just today I had to replace some parts for the engine, because somehow in the test flights they took damage. So as you can see, I had to repair the combustor, and we now have a total cost of over $50,000 already. So that's the maintenance hangar, a quick glance at it at least. And we are going to cover the payload in a second. We can connect the GPU as well if we like, and also tow and push the aircraft around manually, I think, via your joystick inputs or the yoke inputs. And this is how the TBM-900 will start on the ramp. The door will be open, and all these tube covers and the exhaust and prop covers and everything will be attached. And also the chocks will be in place. So now let's get ready to remove all that and get flying. And here we are in the cockpit, and you can see it's beautifully modeled. Beautiful textures, everything is very shiny. And we have three large displays right here for the G1000. And also in a digital standby instrument. We also have this very unique H-pattern throttle handle and condition lever handle. There's also a fully operational circuit breaker panel in this aircraft, so all the circuit breakers right here can pop out, but they all seem to be okay in this case. And now let us have a look at the payload manager. And here we have several click spots for all these ties, caps and covers that are attached to the aircraft. We can also remove the chocks right here and open the doors. So let's open all the doors. And as you can see, now it's all opened up and the passengers can board the aircraft, because we have 6 passengers today. That's what SimBrief gave us for the payload. And we can now also click all these ties and caps and pitot covers and wicks and everything to remove them all. And now we are going to load the aircraft by clicking the payload portion right here. So we have a pilot in charge at the moment, and we are going to add a co-pilot as well. And then several more people. So I guess SimBrief meant that the aircraft is fully loaded with 6 people and not 6 passengers only. And we are going to see what happens regarding the weight. So now we are relatively close to what SimBrief suggested. We are now at a zero fuel weight of 2.67 tons. And that is close to SimBrief's value, and we need some more fuel as well. The takeoff weight will be around 3.1. So now let's close this payload segment, and we can open the fuel caps. You can click each of the fuel caps right here to then individually load the fuel. This is in US gallons, unfortunately, so it would have been nice in kilos as well. So now we have to guess a little bit. But that is close. 60 US gallons in each tank. That's fine. So we are quite heavily loaded on our trip to Paderborn. And now let us close the doors and remove the chocks, and we are getting ready to power the bird up. So we are clicking each of these door segments right here. And also the chocks can be removed either right here in the payload and balance window or in the menu at the left hand side. The people are strapped in, even though there are only visible models for the co-pilot and pilot, as you can see, not for the passengers. So here we are in the cockpit again, and now let us start with the initial power up of the TBM-900. At the overhead we are going to flick up this crash bar handle. And this will give the aircraft initial juice for the most essential systems, like the PFD and the standby instrument as well. But we are going one step further and also enable the battery as the source by flicking this switch up. One position, and now we are getting all the available juice that is that will power all the systems. And we can also enable the NEV light.
Aura warning, okay.
And the aircraft will perform some self tests, some system tests, and we can also push this rightmost soft key of the large MFD. And everything is powering up in a very realistic manner. So as I said before, this aircraft features a really good system simulation. Some more systems are aligning right here until they are fully available. And now we are going to deal with the flight planning and also the ATC in a second. So for the preparation of this flight, we are not going to enable the GPU. As you can see, the battery is slowly discharging. So we have to hurry a little bit, but it will be fine. So let us load our flight plan for today. And luckily we have this keyboard integrated into the TBM-900, so we don't necessarily have to use these rotary knobs to enter stuff for the flight plan. So let us click the flight plan page, and we are going to cycle the page to the right. And here we have our flight plan overview, or the safe flight plans within X-Plane. And as you can see, we are taking this one, we are pushing the cursor to select it, and then we hit enter. Right here you have the range knob for the MFD map range, so the amount of landscape that you can see on the display pretty much. And back there we have IRCAM, which is the first waypoint in our flight plan. But we are also going to insert a SIT. And how this can be accomplished I'm going to show you right now. We are going to the flight plan page again, activating the cursor, and we make sure that our departure airport is selected. Now we are pushing the PROC button for the procedures, and we are selecting a departure. And now we are hitting enter, and we are choosing the AirQ1 Sierra departure, and hit enter again, and again for loading it, and that will insert it now into the flight plan. So when we are now cycling through the waypoints, you can see that we really have the SIT inserted. And this will be fine for now. We are going to insert the arrival procedure later. And this is our initial flight planning done. I'm going to show you all the extra pages on the MFD later regarding the weather radar, terrain radar and such things. And now let's continue with ATC. First let's listen to ATIS, and I'm going to bring up the AVTAP that you can find in the left door right here in this door pouch, however it's called. And right here you can see the airport diagram of Weeze Niederrhein Airport and where we are situated at the moment. We are planning to depart runway 27. The heading will be 272. And the ATIS frequency is 124.45. So let's enter that into the COM radio, which you can find up here. So on the left hand side you have the NEV radio functionality, and on the right hand side you have the COM radios. So it's 124.45. And that should be working with PF3 ATC, so let's try it out.
This is Niederrhein Airport Information, Lima. Weather at 1100 Zulu. Winds 231 at 10. Visibility 10. Sky condition 3500 few. Temperature 12. Dew point 5. 1024. ILS runway 27 in use. Land.
So that was ATIS, and now we are going to set the altimeter via the barrow knob to 1024. So the airport elevation is around 100 feet, as we can see for the elevation of our holding short point 105, and that matches up pretty nicely. Also, we can set the altimeter for the standby instrument by hitting the plus button until we reach 1024, and we can already prepare the tower frequency for our clearance, 129.40. So that's already set, and now we are going to start the engine before our battery runs out of juice. And by the way, you can hide the AV tab by clicking again in this door pouch, and it will be removed from the yoke. And you also have a checklist function on the MFD, the rightmost soft key right here, and that can also be very convenient. The first checklist that you get is the before starting engine checklist, so no initial power-up checklist is provided, but as you could see, the initial power-up is really simple. So, to get going for engine start, we're going to enable the main generator and the strobe lights, because this aircraft doesn't feature a rotating beacon. We have to use the strobe lights to let everybody know that we are going to start the engines. And we can also set the panel lighting via this knob. And if you like, you can also enable the cabin and access lighting, but it's very bright in the daytime, so we don't need it necessarily. And the rest of the switches is also correctly set for now. The starter is off, ignition on auto. The AUX BP pump we are going to need in a second, so we can already switch it on maybe. Fuel select is on manual and the AP trim switch is off. That's all fine. And we also have to enable a fuel tank. So usually you take the fuel tank that has more fuel in it, but as we did load the fuel tanks equally just some minutes ago, we can choose whichever one we like. Let's start with the right fuel pump. And now we have a look at the checklist. The man override control is in the backward position. That is this red lever right here. Checked. The throttle is cut off. Checked. Strobes on. AUX BP fuel is on. Propeller area is clear, I'm sure, because there are no actual people in X-Plane. So now comes the actual engine start. So as you can see, the procedure will be when the NG, which is this readout, will reach 13% or more, and the ITT, the turbine temperature, will be below 150 degrees Celsius for sure, because the engine didn't run before, it's very cold, and the timer will be below 20 seconds. Then we are going to push up the throttle lever right here, one notch, to the low idle position. So let's do it. We are going to start the timer. Starter switch on and hold it for some seconds. Release. We have NG rising 12-13%. Low idle. We are further observing the engine gauges right here. We have 20 seconds. That's all good. Now at 52% NG, we are going in the flight idle position. And that was a good start, we can now stop and reset the timers. Alrighty, so in the bottom right corner you can see this indicator for the actual hardware throttle, where that is located at the moment. So now I'm going to sync my hardware throttle on my joystick with the throttle of the aircraft. That's done. So if you will, this in this H pattern throttle quadrant, you have this right-hand side for the condition lever, so it's fuel off, low idle and high idle, so it's all feathered, And then this bigger portion on the left is your power handle, pretty much. Your throttle handle that is unfeathered and will go from full power to taxi range and reverse as well. As we can see right here, this is taxi range and then comes full reverse thrust. And now the after start flow. We are going to switch the AUX BP pump, the fuel pump, to auto. Fuel selector to auto, AP trims to on. The starter is off, that's how it should be. And the rest is all fine on the overhead. And also we are going to turn on the bleeds to auto. And the AC, the air conditioning, to auto as well. So it's a very automated aircraft, as you can see. So on the checklist we are going to verify that the engine parameters are all beautiful and checked. The AUX BP fuel switch is auto. Fuel selector switch is auto as well. Generator is on main. AP trims are on. That's all great. Bleed and AC auto. Pressurization mode. This one right here is also in the auto position. Okay, the LFE selection, that's the landing field elevation that you can see right here. And as we are using a flight plan, it has automatically been set to the landing field elevation of Paderborn. That's awesome. Altimeters are checked. Yeah, this is what we are going to do before taxiing. So now let us contact ATC for our clearance.
Alatus Delta Echo Sierra Charlie Delta clear to Echo Delta Lima Papa Delta Papa departure time to flight level 120 Squawk 5364.
Roger, clear to Echo Delta Lima Papa departure using Delta Papa clear to flight level 120 Squawk 5364 Delta Echo Sierra Charlie Delta.
And we have our clearance. So as you could see, I dialed in the altitude via the altitude selector button, or this knob right here, to 12,000 feet. Our barrel is correctly set, and I also already dialed in the heading for the runway, which is 272, via this knob right here. And also I set the squawk. So the squawk will be set on the transponder page. Here you can set it to standby on and altitude, and also set the code by clicking here. If for some reason you don't have the synthetic vision active on the PFD, you can activate that by going to the PFD options. And right here on the left hand side you have SynVis, which is the synthetic vision. And as you can see, I have pretty much all enabled except the horizon heading, which will give you the heading readouts on the artificial horizon. I don't necessarily need that, so it's disabled. Also, unfortunately, on the X-Plane 11 synthetic vision, you don't have the airport taxiways and aprons. So as you can see, we are now standing on the grass pretty much. And only the runway will be visible right here. But that cannot be changed, I think. Okay, so next up we are going to taxi. Fasten your seatbelts and hold on tight, my friends. So before requesting our taxi clearance, we are going to extend the flaps to the takeoff position. And we are going to set the trims. Down here you can see the trims for elevator, rudder and ailerons. So we still have to set the elevator trim to takeoff position within the green band. That is now done. Flaps are takeoff. We can also enable the inertial separator. That gets enabled for taxiing. As far as I know, that prevents the engine to suck dirt from the ground. And now let us request taxi clearance.
Lotus Delta Echo Sierra Charlie Delta Roger, taxi to holding point, runway 27 using taxi Sierra Charlie Delta.
And there is our taxi clearance. As you can see on the map display, we can zoom in very far. Unfortunately, the aircraft symbol on the map is white, so it doesn't really stick out on the taxiways and aprons. But we are now going to enable our taxi lights, and now we can taxi. And when taxiing the very powerful TBM-900 aircraft, you will do it mostly in the taxi range of your throttle quadrant. So you have to push the button on your joystick for reversers, to toggle the reversers, I think, that is used for that. and you can then move your throttles in the taxi position. So not too far that you don't get into the reverse range, that is not needed, but only within the taxi range, because otherwise this very powerful turboprop aircraft will become too fast during taxi. And that's how that is working. You can see your ground speed in the top left corner right here. The GS value should be below 20 knots when taxiing.
Left to holding point, runway 27.
So here we are holding short of runway 27 and nearly ready for departure. So now let's make sure that everything is set, the landing lights get enabled. Takeoff flaps are set and also the trims are set. Also on the AV-tab I now brought up the SIT, the departure procedure, chart. So directly after takeoff we are going to fly heading 286 pretty much. So I'm going to dial in 286 as the heading after lining up. We are going to enable the transponder to altitude. And I think we are now ready for takeoff pretty much. We only have to activate the pitot heaters left and right, and we are good for takeoff. So now let's request it from tower.
Pilatus, Delta Echo, Sierra Charlie, Delta Wings 230 at 4 runway 27 cleared for takeoff.
By the way, our call sign is Pilatus for PF3 ATC because it doesn't know the correct aircraft manufacturer. Also, before taking off, I'm going to show you the weather radar and TCAS pages for the MFD that you can access by rotating the little knob for the FMS right here. So this is the traffic map display. We are going to say operate. And you also have several altitude modes, so above, normal, below, as you might know it from the airliners. Toggling one page forward, we have the weather radar that we can turn on by going to mode and standby for now. We can enable it when airborne. And we also have a terrain map that is of course all red now, because we are going to take off in a second. So without further ado, let's move. So we are pretty well aligned, and now I'm going to set up heading 286 after departure. This is also where the FMS track or the GPS track is heading to initially after takeoff. So I think we are ready for takeoff, let's go. Should stay short of the yellow band of the torque percent readout. And we can rotate. That was quite wobbly. And gear up.
Pilatus, Delta Echo, Sierra Charlie, Delta Contact, departure on 128.2.
Roger, 128.2,
Delta Echo, Sierra Charlie, Delta.
And now the flaps can be raised as well.
Departure, Pilatus, Delta, Echo, Sierra, Charlie, Delta, Alpha 1004, flight level 120.
Sierra, Delta, Echo, Sierra, Charlie, Delta, squawk, dead end, QNH 1024.
And now we are going to bring back the throttles a bit and turn off the inertia separator. I must admit that I don't really enjoy hand flying the aircraft yet, so it feels very sluggish, very unresponsive to your inputs. But the elevator trim is very responsive, so you can better control your vertical path via the elevator trim than really flying it via the yoke, which is a bit strange. And I'm now aiming at a speed of around 124 knots for the climb. So also we make sure that the yaw damper is enabled and we are choosing a navigation mode and flight level change. So let's now engage the autopilot. And you can alter your flight level change speed via the vertical speed wheel that you can find right here. So I'm aiming for 125 knots maybe. So that was quite a wobbly departure. I'm not very happy with it, but whatever. We are above 5,000 feet, that means standard barrows for Germany. Setting them for the primary flight display by clicking the barrow knob in the center. And for the standby thingy as well. You can also quickly sync the heading by pushing the knob in the center. So now we have the yaw damper enabled, the autopilot. We are in NEV mode, which means the aircraft will follow the GPS flight plan. And we are in flight level change mode. So the aircraft will climb at a given airspeed of 125 knots. And we can add in a bit more of torque maybe, so pushing the throttles a bit forward. Alrighty, we now have negative 3 degrees Celsius and we are relatively close to clouds, yes indeed. Let's turn on some prop and windshield anti-icing. Okay, we are still in our sit and we can definitely turn off the landing lights now. Also coming up on 10,000 feet right here. And we can now also enable our weather radar, if we like. So mode and weather. It should be accurately working right here in X-Plane 11. We can alter your tilt and bearing as well, if you like, via this knob right here. And we can climb further, so I dialed in the new climb altitude, 15,000, which is also our cruise altitude. Now let's go into vertical speed first. As you can see, the throttles are quite far back now, because I'm aiming at a climb speed again of 125 knots approximately. Now I'm aiming at a smooth transition from vertical speed to flight level change. That was okay. So the weather radar is now on. And on the terrain radar, of course, we don't have any returns because we are in quite flat landscapes right here in Germany. As you can see, also the traffic advisory system is working. Because right here we have some aircraft by Just Flights Traffic Global flying past us. And as we are dealing with the maps right now, you can also alter your inset map a bit on the PFD. So you can enable traffic and topographic and terrain and whatnot, Nexred weather radars as well. And you can also declutter it. And the same applies to the big map right here. You can also declutter that further if you like. There's also a chart functionality with this aircraft to show airport charts on the MFD, but that is only working with some, for me, unknown chart provider, so that doesn't work with Navigraph charts or Aerosoft charts neither. And now we did reach our cruise altitude. The aircraft is accelerating now, and as long as you are within the green bands right here for the torque and for the NG and ITT, everything is fine. You can fly pretty much any setting you want right here to go as fast as possible. And as you can see now, our departure procedure is complete and we are now en route to a Paderborn airport. Also on the MFD on the map page you get some traffic returns right here. And now let's have another look at the checklist. We are still on the before takeoff checklist right here. If you like to change the checklist that is being shown right now, you can use the large wheel and then you can rotate the smaller wheel or the smaller knob to select whatever checklist you like and hit enter. So the recommended climb speed was 124, we did accomplish that relatively nicely. Trims are adjusted, yaw damper is on. Lights are set, throttle is good. ECS panel is okay, fuel tank gauges are good. And de-icing is good as well. If you are flying through heavy precipitation, you can turn on the ignition and the inertial separator. So the ignition is up here. You switch that to the on position, like this. And you also get a nice little warning. And the inertial separator that we did see before is down here. And for the cruise checklist, you only have the throttle to set. I'm also going to show you a nice little trick in a second for the throttle setting. Pressurization is checked. We are within green limits right here. Cabin altitude is fine. Also above 15 or above 10,000 feet you could enable your oxygen. So this is the oxygen switch right here. Maybe that's quite a good idea. And the rest is fine as well. So regarding the throttle setting during cruise, if you find it to be too sensitive when trying to do fine adjustments to it, then you can click this throttle friction wheel at the side right here. This will enable friction mode for your hardware throttle. And you can do fine adjustments to the throttle a lot more easy. So the inputs will not be that severe anymore. But it will be a lot easier to do fine adjustments, as I said. As you can see, it's not that far out anymore to Paderborn. We should also plan our approach and our arrival. Just as we have to descend, great. So we are going to land runway 24. Regarding the winds, so let's plan for an approach. We are scrolling down to our arrival airport and hit PROC, procedures, and we are planning for an approach, enter. And ILS-24, enter, and via vectors. Yes, that's what we are planning for. Minimums will be, for an ILS approach, 874 barrow. So 874 on the barometric. Readout. Alright. So we say 850. Oops, 850, like this. Enter. and load. So now let us descend to 12,000 feet. Let's begin with a vertical speed descent. And I'm going to disengage this friction lock thingy, like this. And if you have an intact flight plan, then you can also use the VNAV functionality. So I'm not very experienced with the G1000 flight planning stuff, and we should have planned our approach before taking off, because now everything is screwed up. But if you have an intact flight plan, then you can also use the VNAV function, or the VNAV capability of the aircraft and the autopilot.
Delta, Echo, Sierra, Charlie, Delta, maintain heading 100, expect vectors for the ILS, runway 24.
Delta, Echo, Sierra, Charlie, Delta.
So we can expect vectors. So for now we are maintaining heading 100. So as I said, when your flight plan is really accurately thought out from the beginning, then you can use the VNAV button right here for descent as well. And we have to turn left now. So on the chart we can see that the ILS frequency for runway 24 at Paderborn is 10855. And this will get auto-tuned in the TBM-900. So it's now auto-tuned in NEV 1 and 2. And the course will be 235. That can be set via the course 1 marker right here. We are going to change the CDI source from GPS to localizer 1. So the course will be 235. Like this. So our ILS approach is now prepared as well. Also for the PFD we can turn on the DME, the distance measurement equipment, so we know how far we are away from the localizer. So it's working for an F1 and we seem to be 18 miles out.
Delta, Echo, Sierra, Charlie, Delta, descent 3500 on 1020.
Bounce off flight level 7043. Bounce 500 on 1020. Delta, Echo, Sierra, Charlie, Delta.
Landing gear.
So now we have been cleared down to 3500 feet. And we are descending in flight level change mode now, at 170 knots. And the altimeter will be 1020, that's also what ATC provided us with. So we can prepare that already.
Delta, Delta, Echo, Sierra, Charlie, Delta, cleared for the ILS runway 24. Approach contact tower on 133.37 when established. Descend on ILS.
Out of 5,000 until established on the ILS runway 24. Descend on ILS. Tower on 133.37 when established. Delta, Echo, Sierra, Charlie, Delta.
And we have been cleared for the ILS 24 approach. We are now coming up on the localizer course, so I'm going to arm the localizer capture. As you can see now for the lateral navigation, it's armed localizer. We are still flying heading though. And we are in flight level change mode, 170 knots. We have the glide slope active already, so we are pretty much right on the marks. So let's go to vertical speed mode instead. And I'm aiming for 160 knots for now, for the approach. We could already extend takeoff flaps, so the takeoff flaps maximum speed is 178 knots. And the maximum gear extension speed is 150 knots. So the landing light is already on, we should now shortly be intercepting the localizer. And there the localizer is coming in. Now the aircraft will catch that. Now we can already sync the heading to 235 as well. And we even have some ILS glide slope intercept pathway on the PFD, which is totally awesome on the synthetic vision.
Tower, Militus, Delta, Echo,
now we are arming approach for the glide slope intercept.
Delta Echo Sierra Charlie. Delta, continue approach. Your number 14 landing.
So now let's go take off flaps.
Number 14 landing. Militus Delta Echo Sierra Charlie Delta.
Landing gear.
And indeed we can already extend the landing gear at 3000 feet. And the gear is down, three greens. Go around altitude will be 3000, so we are setting that up as well. And at 122 knots maximum, we can extend our landing flaps. So we are going to do that shortly as well. And also for landing, we are going to switch off the anti-icing and turn on the inertial separator.
Delta Echo Sierra Charlie Delta Wind 325 and 12 and 8120 clear to land runway 24.
That's the caution for the inertial separator that we activated. We can also flick up this little angle of attack indicator right here. So if you are close to a stall, then exactly this will happen. Then these bar will be lighting up. I think we can go landing flaps now. Even though I don't think we were close to a stall, but whatever. And just before landing, we are going to turn off the autopilot and the yaw damper, and then we can try to land smoothly. I hope it will be working out. The approach speed will be approximately 90 knots. So what we are at right now, that's fine. Getting a little less of this nose down attitude, that would be nice. So between 85 and 90 knots, that's what I'm aiming at right now. And now autopilot off. And the yaw damper automatically disconnects as well, it seems. And now, as usual, trying to stay on the glide slope diamond and also within localizer limits. And we are landing in Paderborn.
Wind shear. Wind shear.
Minimum.
Continue in the wind shear.
Wind shear.
Delta Echo Sierra Charlie. Delta, contact ground 121.92,
when clear of the exit. 121.92, Delta, Echo, Sierra, Charlie, Delta.
And as usual in my tutorials, I'm doing quite a hard landing, so I don't know what's up with that, but I cannot change it. If you want to see a butter landing with the TBM-900, I'm going to link a video in the description down below.
Ground, Pilatus, Delta, Echo, Sierra, Charlie, Delta, clear of the active runway.
And there we are, welcome in Paderborn, my friends. I hope you enjoyed the flight.
Pilatus, Delta, Echo, Sierra, Charlie, Delta, hold your position. Pilatus, Delta, Echo, Sierra, Charlie, Delta, taxi to terminal.
Raising the flaps.
Taxi to terminal. Delta. Echo. Sierra. Charlie. Delta.
Taxi lights on. And down here we can switch off the pitot heaters. Inertia separators stay on for now. Flight director can be disabled. And the trims will be reset. So the takeoff trim right here and the rudder trim as well. Rudder trim can be set via the this switch on the yoke, if you don't have a button mapped on your joystick or yoke. And also all the extra radar functionality will be disabled. Traffic radar is in standby mode, weather radar is in standby mode as well, that's fine. And also the transponder gets automatically switched to on instead of altitude, so it's all very automated right here. So now on the flight plan page I'm going to remove or delete the flight plan. And now we are looking for a nice spot to park. And there we are. So, taxi light off. And now we are going to need the checklist. Also, the inertia separator gets disabled. We don't need the tablet anymore. And also the AC, the air conditioning, gets disabled. Bleed off. So, the parking brake is on. Bleed switch. The engine gets feathered now in low idle. Before shutdown. So the AP trim switch gets disabled as well. Oxygen we don't need anymore. So I guess now the engine has idled enough and we can shut it down. So the aux BP pump off, fuel selector to manual, strobes off, and fuel selector off as well. That's checked, exterior lights are off, all switches off, aux BP, fuel select, oxygen, parking brake. Yeah, when the chocks are in place, we can disable the parking brake. And that's all great. We successfully accomplished our flight. So the final two steps now are to disable the battery, so the source switch gets to the off position and the crash handle down, and that's it. Now the standby indicator will shut down in 5 minutes, or you can also toggle the menu page until you are at the shutdown indication and you can hold the plus button until it's fully shut down. Before ending the tutorial, there's one last thing I wanted to cover, and that is the so-called motoring of the engine. As you can see now, after shutting it down, it is still super hot and there's still some blur or some heat coming out of the exhaust. And that's because the engine still has 300 degrees of temperature. As you can see here on the ITT gauge, still close to 300 degrees. And as you might remember from the checklist, the ITT has to be below 150 degrees Celsius. So what can be done if you want to start the engine again right now? And that is the so-called motoring procedure. So we are going through the checklist of the pilot operating handbook for the TBM-900. This doesn't come with the aircraft, but this is the original handbook by the manufacturer of the aircraft. So the man override control is backwards. The throttle is cut off. Yes, it is. We need to select a fuel tank. And we are taking the right tank once again. And the aux BP switch has to be on. Also, the strobes are already on. And now aux BP is up here. Alright, and now the important thing is that the ignition switch is in the off position, so that the engine will not ignite and try to fire up. So up here ignition gets to off. And now, as I don't want to start the engine again after this procedure, we are taking this these steps right here to cool the engine, and that's it. So the starter switch comes to the on position and motoring for maximum 30 seconds. And then starter switch to abort. That means we are going to need the timer again. So timer on and start switch on. And now we are going to motor the engine for about 30 seconds. ITT is coming down, as you can see. And there we are. Coming up on 30 seconds, that's good. And starter abort. And as you can see, this procedure really cooled down the engine a lot. Now we are down from 300 degrees Celsius down to 120, and that is awesome. And this will conclude our today's tutorial for the Hot Start TBM-900. I hope you could learn something, and it was quite a fun flight for me, even though it didn't work out perfectly, but still, it was okay. If you enjoyed the video, then please don't forget to hit the like button and also make sure to subscribe for further flight sim content to come very soon. And yeah, this will be it for today. Have a good one and I will see you next time. Bye bye.